Blood Money came in the wake of the massacres in East Timor, but it took a different angle. Rather than looking for the murderers, it looked for who paid for it, which was actually a more interesting trail. And it was a real primary investigation in the ruins of Dili, in all the finance ministries and the governor's office. There was, you know, 2 foot of paper. And I went in with some former public service and some students and said, well, let's go through that paper. We did what the Australian government didn't do. This is the great thing about Dateline, actually. Normally, to do a television story, you need to convince somebody. You've got this schedule, it's nailed down, you've got the minister, and this is what you're going to do, here's the documents. You're going in and you're really just joining the dots. I mean, you'd be amazed the number of current affairs programs that are made like that. They know exactly who they're going to see, what they're going to say, and how they're going to tell their story. The beauty of Dateline, because, you know, we were working by ourselves, is that that criteria could be lowered. And so I just got permission to, yes, you can go to Timor. That's it, I had nothing. So that's a great way to work as a journalist. But the story took a turn when I started meeting public servants who were talking about the money. In fact, specifically, a militiaman told me that he was paid a bounty. He was paid a bounty for ears, and that the governor's office paid him the bounty. So if there was a single thread that that prompted that story, it was that event. Ear, money, governor's office, let's go to the governor's office. And that's where it started. And I think even in the story itself, you actually see us, we're rifling through documents, and we started to pull together the chain of these documents that led to Jakarta and ultimately led to the World Bank. If you remember, the Indonesian government at the time, and indeed the Australian government, were calling guys like this militia leader rogue elements. They weren't within, you know, it wasn't what Indonesia was authorising, it was these mad locals who were operating on their own. Well, it wasn't mad, no, they were mad and they were locals, they weren't operating on their own, they were operating with the complete complicity and authority of ministers of the Indonesian government and ministries that were taking money from the World Bank and paying them. To be honest with you, it's very intimidating. You don't go to walk into Jakarta and, you know, basically call a minister a murderer and feel terribly comfortable about it.
I don't know what you're talking about, because, you know, you are talking about things as if we are in the business of funding the militia,
exactly.
which is not.
He knew what I had. He knew what I had, so that was a little bit worrying in itself. But there was no denials at that point. After the no denials, he realised that this could undercut this reputation that he'd had for 30 years as the Mr. Reasonable of Indonesia. It was turning to dust in front of his eyes, and I hope it did destroy his reputation. There used to be a few sort of datelines around the world. They've all gone. I mean, Dateline really is it. For a journalist, there's two places to work, Four Corners or Dateline. Full stop, nowhere else. It's the greatest. And it's all international. I like international. You know, it is Australia's oldest international current affairs program. It takes it seriously. It's not just entertainment. It's not foreign entertainment. It's fascinating insights, you know, behind the scenes of the big moments in history. As a journalist, it's pretty hard to get better than that.